Welcome.
Welcome, everyone.
Welcome to Mosaic Church Online.
We're so happy you could join us this morning. Liz, I'm so happy I'm in your place and right next to you. How has your week been?
Oh, thank you. It's lovely to be here. It's been a wonderful week. I managed to get together with some dear friends, close friends, ladies who I've been in ministry with for about 3 years. And all these months we've been doing the Zoom thing. Well, we got together face to face for the first time in all these months. And it was amazing. It was just so good. You know, we do need that human contact. It's so necessary.
We do. And I could imagine the fun that you shared over some afternoon tea and the stories, probably, and the noodles.
Absolutely, absolutely. And a lot of noise.
A lot of noise.
Yes.
We all miss that. Well, speaking of fun, we have something fun planned for you all for your online experience this morning. We would like to invite you to participate in this little game called Are You Smarter Than a Fifth Grader? Which is a popular US quiz show. So we're gonna have some just a couple of questions, and we would like you to type in your answers in the comments in every question that we ask. So are you ready, Liz?
I'm ready.
Would you like to participate? Okay, let's see. The first question is, how many nouns are in the following sentence? The rabbit ran to the cafeteria and ate a big salad. So is it A, 2, B, 3, or C, 4 nouns? What's your best answer, Liz? Nouns in that sentence. Rabbit and cafeteria ate a big salad.
Nouns. 3.
3. And the correct answer is, you're right!
Yay! Got it.
Nothing greater. The answer is letter B, 3 nouns. The second question would be, what planet is closest to the sun? Is it A, Venus, B, Mercury, or C, Earth? Do you remember your science class?
No, I don't. And I'm literally gonna guess.
Planet closest to the sun. A, Venus, B, Mercury, or C, Earth?
Earth?
Let's see.
I knew it was wrong when I was saying it.
Yeah, it's been a long time when you were fifth grader.
Yeah.
The correct answer is B. So let's see if our people got the correct answer as well. The next question is, what is condensation? Another science question. Is it A, when gas changes into liquid, or B, when ice becomes steam, or letter C, when liquid changes to gas? Condensation. What is your best guess, Liz?
Oh, I can't remember what was one, but anyway, I think it was one.
It's the letter A.
A.
When gas changes into liquid, let's see. And you're right! Yay! It's when gas changes into liquid. Good answer, Liz, or guess. Okay, ready for the next question? A heptagon is a shape with how many sides? Heptagon. Is it A5, B7, or C9? Best guess.
I want to say B.
B7. Let's see. It's correct, Liz.
Yay!
Wonderful. Seven sides.
Good
job. Okay, this is our last question. Which is the biggest continent? This is an easy one. Is it A, Asia, B, Africa, or C, Europe?
A.
You are so confident in that answer.
Yes.
Let's see if you're right. And it is A.
Wonderful.
Good job, Liz. You're definitely smarter than a fifth grader.
Oh dear.
All right. Okay, Liz, what can we expect this morning?
Well, if you're here for the first time, what you can expect is this. We'll be together for about 45 minutes. We're going to sing a song together, and we're going to hear some amazing stories of what's been happening here at Mosaic.
And as well as Jeremy will also talk about how to not be afraid in his message, how to not be afraid even when there's something to be afraid of. And then after that, we're gonna have a closing song at the end. And then we have prepared something special for the kids. So we want you to, you know, stick around. And if you want more information on our church, just click on the link in the group chat to fill out your details. And Jeremy, our pastor, will be in touch with you. So this morning, we're gonna hand it over to OJ and the band. We hope you could join us in singing this worship song and We hope you have a good day. Thank you, OJ, Dina, and the band for leading us into that time of worship. Well, let me share with you something incredible and amazing that happened this week. It has been week 4 of our food delivery to all needy families and individuals that we get to know through social media. And this week has been the highest, with 86 people receiving bags of groceries to last them throughout the week. And we'd like to thank Jerry Nolan for her excellent leadership and organizing the team of volunteers who do the packing and the grocery runs and then the drop off to these locations where people actually line up to receive those food donations. So it's been a great week. Thank you everyone for being involved, and thank you for your donations, because we may never see these people who receive these goodies, but you're making a difference with your generosity and your giving throughout the week with this you know, with this food parcels, delivering to the location, volunteering on the day. It's been amazing, Liz.
That's wonderful. Really wonderful. Mm-hmm. Well done, Mosaic. And now over to Jeremy for today's message.
Hi, my name is Jeremy. I'm the pastor of Mosaic. And today I'm going to talk about something that many of us struggle with, especially right now when many of us have had our whole world turned upside down. It's fear. Today I'm going to share with you how you can be not afraid even though you have something to be afraid of. So stick around to the end and I'll share that with you. This week on social media, I saw my friends Peter and Lara and their kids who recently moved to Hungary. They're standing outside their house all looking at the rain. And I thought to myself two things. First, one is just how much I miss rain. We just don't get a lot of it here in Dubai. And I love the smell that you get of rain right before it storms. And I got a funny story of Zeke, my son, telling God that he wanted more rain. We had just taken some vacation in the United States, and Zeke was about 1 to 2 years old. And he had actually never seen rain before in his life. And it was raining pretty hard outside, and so we decided, let's let Zeke go out and play in the rain. I think his goal was to jump in as many puddles as he could find and get it as wet and as dirty as he possibly could, and he succeeded at that. But eventually the rain started to slow down, and it went to a sprinkle. And Zeke looked straight up at the sky and put both hands right up in there and he said, more! He wanted more rain. The second thing that I thought when I saw my friends looking at the rain was just how powerful nature is, how small we can feel around nature. Sometimes nature even brings out fear in me. I know that definitely happened for me when I went white water rafting down the Zambezi River on the border between Zimbabwe and Zambia. I went there on vacation and had never really done any white water rafting in my life. And so we go down and we jump in and we test out our life vests to see how strong they are, make sure they're on tight. And we go down these rapids. And I think there's levels 1 to 5 on a rapids. And these were all rapids levels 4 and 5. And that really meant nothing to me, but it just meant that they were big. And it was quite exciting. I was having a great time. We were going down the river, just a lot of fun. And it was a great time until I fell out of the boat. Here's a great picture for you. That's me with my legs up in the air and my body underneath the water. I went down this rapid and fell out backwards. And the raft started going down the river. And I started kind of flowing behind it. And I was eventually catching up with the raft. And right when I got to the raft, I lifted up both hands to grab onto something and pull myself up, and I couldn't grab onto anything, and I went straight under the raft. So those life vests are pretty strong, and so now that life vest's holding me up really tight, and my head is hitting the bottom of the raft. I'm stuck under the raft, and I don't know which way to go. So I'm on the bottom of the raft, I'm like trying to get somewhere, but I didn't know if I was going left or right, forward or backwards. I didn't know, and it was pretty scary because I was underwater. And eventually I came up along the side and I breathed a big gasp of air. But the thing is that it was scary. I learned from my past experiences that I don't want to do white water rafting anymore. It was fun and exciting and it was a great time, but I don't want to do that anymore. You see, fear, none of us want to be, to let fear be the boss of us. And for some of us, it's not. But for others, there is an element of fear that creeps into our daily life. You see, fear robs us of opportunities. It interferes in our relationships. It keeps us awake at night. And the interesting thing about it is that fear is a byproduct of actually something good. Fear is a byproduct of our ability to accumulate knowledge and project it into the future. Kind of similar to that white water rafting experience I had. It's one of God's greatest gifts, this ability that enables us to imagine and hope and dream. You know, without it, we couldn't look forward or plan anything. We would never say, I can't wait to go and do that. Or, you see, our ability to imagine has more upside than downside. But it does create this potential to fear. It creates the endless question of, what if? You see, sometimes fear is a good thing. It does have its place, but you don't want fear to be the boss of you. It puts you off balance. It makes you distracted and overly protective. Fear causes us to become really self-absorbed. You see, Jesus had so much to say about fear. One of his most famous quotes is, "Fear not." You know, that's super easy to say, but virtually impossible to do. Why did Jesus say that? You know, Jesus' first century followers felt the same way. After choosing the 12 disciples, he told them, "Look, I'm sending you out like sheep among wolves. You're going to be arrested and beaten." Then he says, "Don't be afraid." That didn't make any sense to them. And you know what? It didn't work. They were afraid. So Jesus took them on a little field trip to teach them a lesson. Matthew, one of Jesus' closest disciples, tells us what happened. He tells us in the book of Matthew, chapter 28, verse 23 is where we start. He says, "Then he got into the boat, and his disciples followed him. Suddenly, a furious storm came up on the lake, so that the waves swept over the boat." They were probably thinking, Jesus said we would be arrested and beaten. Did anyone hear him say we would drown? But Jesus was sleeping, verse 24, which is just amazing that Jesus was sleeping in this while a storm was going on. I think he was sleeping, or maybe he was possibly pretending to sleep. Verse 25, "The disciples went and woke him, saying, 'Lord, save us, we're going to drown.'" And I find this verse really interesting. They came to Jesus saying, "Save us." I think it's one of two things. Either they're like handing him a bucket saying, "Save us, do your job and help throw water out of here." Or they were saying, "Save us, we've seen you heal. We've seen you feed thousands. We believe that you can do something with us. Help save us. We're going to drown." I think the latter one is probably it. And then Jesus replied, "You of little faith, why are you so afraid?" And I think the disciples were like, "Well, we're afraid because there's a furious storm outside. The waves are sweeping over the boat and we're going to drown. And when you may drown, we are afraid." Verse 26, "Then he got up and rebuked the winds and the waves, and it was completely calm. The men were amazed and asked, 'What kind of man is this? Even the winds and the waves obey him.'" You see, when Peter, who was on the boat with Jesus, told this story to Mark, Mark wrote it out like this in his version. It's in Mark 4:41. The literal translation is, "They feared a great fear." The latter fear was greater than the former fear. Their fear of whose presence they were in was greater than the fear of the storm. Growing up in a Christian household, I've heard this story many times, and I think I've kind of become numb to it. I don't see the actual power in having a storm obey Jesus. But think about it for a minute. Think about an actual storm that's happened near you recently. You got that in your head? And what if Jesus was here today in the middle of that wind and rain or whatever that situation that you found yourself in, and Jesus tells it to stop and it actually stops all of a sudden? If it were me, I would be looking at Jesus and thinking something like this. I actually would be thinking about what I said to him recently. Did I say anything that would make him mad? Because if he can make the storm stop, he can probably make it start again. And what about lightning? How does that work? Can he direct it where he wants it to go? That's what I would think. But for the disciples, I think for just a fleeting moment, their confidence in Jesus, their friend, overwhelmed their own fear of possibly drowning. Then while it was still fresh in their minds of what just happened, Jesus underscored their experience with an illustration from nature. Matthew tells us again, he says, "Do not be afraid of those who kill the body, but cannot kill the soul. Rather be afraid of one who can destroy both soul and body in hell. This is what Jesus was saying. Jesus was saying to them, don't you remember the boat ride? You were afraid of the wrong thing. Verse 29, he says, are not two sparrows sold for a penny? Yet not one of them will fall to the ground outside your Father's care. And even the very hairs of your head are all numbered. So don't be afraid. You're worth more than many sparrows. God knows what's going on in your own personal lives, and He cares. The joblessness, the not getting paid, not knowing how you're going to pay rent, not knowing where your next meal is going to come from. Even when bad things happen, we can trust God. And I'm so proud of us as a church. We have gone out, and this particular week, we went and gave food to 86 families to feed for an entire week. That's amazing. I'm so proud of you. And you see, when people were probably wondering, where is my next meal going to come from? And God used us to provide for them. Another time Jesus wanted to teach the disciples about fear was when he walked on water. It's a really famous story. It's found in Matthew 14, verses 26 and 27. When the disciples saw him, they were walking on the lake. They were terrified. They said, is it a ghost? They said, and cried out in fear. But Jesus immediately said to them, take courage, it is I. He said, don't be afraid. He's saying here, as long as I'm here, there's no need to follow your fear, even when there's something to be afraid of. But see, again, it didn't stick. It didn't sink in for the disciples. They didn't get it. They feared all the way right up to the end. Just before Jesus' death, Jesus announced to them three things. He announced to them a new covenant, a new movement, a new command. The disciples got excited. This is exactly what they had been waiting for. They thought he was about to proclaim himself king and the Messiah. Later that night, Jesus was arrested. The disciples panicked. They hid, they lied, and denied. They watched Jesus be crucified. And afterward, they felt like it was all canceled out, this new covenant, this new movement, this new command, along with really everything else that Jesus taught and had claimed about himself. However, 3 days later, they peered into an empty tomb. Later, they met a resurrected Jesus, and it all clicked. It all changed for him. A new movement, a new covenant, a new command. You see, something changed in the disciples after seeing Jesus alive. Jesus' resurrection punctuated everything he taught and said about himself. He could be trusted. Things that made no sense before now made perfect sense, especially what he said about fear. Something changed within the disciples when they saw Jesus alive again. For us, the resurrection is Easter. But for first century believers, it was everything. It was their source of strength, of boldness, of courage. Jesus' resurrection validated the claims he made about himself. It proved that he could be trusted. The world, look, it's still a scary place. It was a scary place for them, but they no longer needed to be afraid. They feared not. The disciples changed dramatically after seeing Jesus alive again. They came out of hiding. They faced down the very men that had arrested Jesus, that had flogged him and crucified him. They went on to change the world. Fear not, change the world. They had lost their fear of death. Peter, who panicked during Jesus' arrest, he lied when he was questioned and later hid. Years after the resurrection, which changed him, he wrote to the people like us, those who believe but have not yet seen Jesus. He tells us in 1 Peter 5:7, cast all your cares on him because he cares for you. This literally means to transfer all your worry to him. Peter should know. He faced things we cannot imagine. He was executed in Nero's Rome. But he was confident that the promise Jesus extended to him was available to us here today. He believed we could say with him and the psalmist, "Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil." And earlier I talked about nature and the fear that it brings. And back in the year 1979, I was a young boy, very, very young, just so you know. And we were living in Wichita Falls, Texas, which is called Tornado Alley. And this particular day, my father had just finished a lunch meeting. And he saw it was really stormy outside. He's like, "I need to get out and I need to go home to my family." So as he left the restaurant and turned the corner, he saw it. He saw a level 5 tornado. Level 5 is the biggest, most fast wind speed tornado that there is. And it was tearing through the city of Wichita Falls. And he realized that he wasn't going to be able to make it home to us. Myself, my mom, and my brother, we had gone across the street to our neighbor's house, and we were all huddled into a small closet in the center of the house. And while the tornado went past us, I could hear the little steel shed that was in the backyard just being torn apart. It was a crazy sounding event for me. Well, my dad had pulled in right beside a liquor store, and he knew that the tornado was turning counterclockwise. So he decided, "Well, I'm going to be on this side of the store because I think this side will protect me the most." And besides the liquor store there was a big grocery store that was near him, and a nursery, meaning a place that sells plants and trees and gardening equipment. Well, the tornado passed by very, very close to him, and he told me about this story of how he felt like he wasn't even himself. It was like it was an outer experience. He was watching it on TV as things were being destroyed all around him. And he felt two things during that moment. The first thing he felt was a sense of peace, a sense of that if he was going to die, he knew where he was going to go. He was going to go heaven. He was going to go be with God. And then the second thing that he felt was that God had a purpose. God was telling him in that moment there that, "I'm not done with you yet, Don. I have a purpose and a plan for you." The tornado goes by, and after he gets out of his car to see the damage, the liquor store was still intact, but the grocery store was completely gone. The only thing that was left was the concrete slab and the two refrigerating walk-in closets where they would refrigerate the food. The nursery that was huge, completely gone except for a concrete slab and pipes sticking out of the ground. You see, whatever you have going on in your life, God is there for you. God cares for you. He knows how many hair is on your head. You see, you can say, "Fear, you're not the boss of me. I already have a boss in me. He conquered life. He conquered death. He is who he claimed to be. He's worthy of my worship and all my trust." The life of Jesus is an invitation and a promise. It's an invitation to follow and fear not, even when there is something to be afraid of. He says to you, he says to me, he says to all of us, "I am with you and I care for you." Let me pray. Dear Father, we love that you love us. Father, we're not worthy. We're not worthy of just all of the love and care that you give us, but you do it anyways. And we're just so thankful for you. We're thankful for a God that is all-knowing, that is all-powerful, that has a plan for us, a plan to do good for us, God. And I just pray that you give us the patience to wait on that plan, that you put the right people in our lives to help guide us in the direction that we should go. God, help us to have peace. Help us to look to you, to put our focus on you when things are not going well, because we know that you love us and that you care for us. And we pray this in Jesus' wonderful name. Amen.
understand me. You understand me. Come to me in the valley of unknowns. You understand me, yeah. You understand me. You understand me, God. You understand me. So I threw all my cares before you. My doubts and fears don't scare you. You're bigger than I thought you were. You're bigger than I thought. I stop all negotiations with the God of all creation. You're bigger than I thought you were. You're bigger than I thought you were.
Understand me. You understand me. Help me reach the faith that's underneath. 'Cause you understand me. You understand me. You understand me, God. You understand me. So I throw all my cares before you. My doubts and fears don't scare you. You're bigger than I thought you were. You're bigger than I thought. I stop all negotiations with the God of all creation. You're bigger than I thought you were. You're bigger than I thought.
Yeah.
in the Father's hands. Leave the rest in the Father's hands. I will rest in the Father's hands. Leave the rest in the Father's hands. So I throw all my cares before you. My doubts and fears don't scare you. You're bigger than I thought you were. You're bigger than I thought. So I stop all negotiations with the God of all creation. You're bigger than I thought you were. You're bigger than I thought you were.
Well, thank you, OJ, Dina, and Ben. That was amazing, as always. You guys are doing a great job. Well, speaking of doing a great job, today we have Carla with us. Carla is our children's minister here at Mosaic. We're excited to have you here.
Glad to be here.
I know that you've been doing some really amazing things with our kids, teaching them more about Jesus. So give us a little update. What are some exciting things that you've been working on lately?
Yeah, so school is almost over, summer is here, and we wanted to celebrate the kids and congratulate them for finishing the school year. We know it wasn't easy, they had to face a lot of new challenges like distance learning or being in lockdown, but you guys did it, you made it, and we're so proud of you. We also want to congratulate and celebrate with the parents because this was all new to you too. So yeah, we celebrate you, and here's a video for you guys.
Was amazing, Carla. Really fun to see all the kids together, even a few of them, if it was just a few of them. I know we couldn't get everyone there, so if your kids were not there, we are still celebrating them. It's an amazing thing what you're doing. So Carla, can you give us a little more update on maybe what you've been doing over the past few months and where we're headed as a church for our children's ministry coming up?
Yes, sure. So we want to make it as easy as possible for parents to have kids church at home, so we sent packages that have activities that you can do with them that's in line with their lesson. And we also have Zoom calls with Upstreet and Transit so we can have discussion and have fun.
Yeah, that's, I know getting that package at our house First off, Zeke and Eliana, it was like Christmas for them. They had a great time opening it. And then it just made it really easy for me as a parent to be able to participate and kind of teach my kid more about Jesus. So that was really helpful. Thanks for doing that. So tell me more about these Zoom calls. Like, how does it work? What do they have to do beforehand?
So we want them to watch the videos first, and then we have the Zoom call so we can talk about what they watched and what they learned in the videos. And sometimes we just have fun. We have games, online games, and we catch up with each other because we know they have had enough Zoom calls during the week. So yeah.
I've definitely had enough Zoom calls too. Can I join? I need some fun. Well, that's great. Well, I appreciate for what you're doing. To be able to find the online videos, where are we putting the online videos?
Yeah, so the videos are on YouTube. Just search for Mosaic Dubai, and then we have a channel for Mosaic Kids.
Yeah, really easy to find. Yeah. Well, that sounds great, Carla. You've done a great job of really transitioning onto online so quickly. So thank you so much for being flexible and adjusting so well. And I want to thank you guys so much for being here today. I hope you have a great week. We'll see you on social media. We put out helpful content almost every single day, so be taking a look at that. Look for us tonight on Facebook and YouTube at 6 p.m. We can't wait to see you all again next week. Have a great one.
Yeah.